Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I will give today a lecture in relation to one of my favorite themes in the field of organ transplantation, namely the use of immunosuppression, especially now today in the field of liver transplantation. And what I will tell you is based on 40 years intensive clinical personal experience in this field of modern medicine. If we go, if we look back in the evolution of liver transplantation, one can see that over time the patient survival improved, and this was mainly due to the introduction of more powerful immunosuppressive drugs. In fact, the aim of transplantation in the beginning was to avoid at any price allograft rejection. But it is important to say that Starzl already very early discovered the fact that liver allograft rejection is a easily reversible phenomenon. Since the 80s, many immunosuppressive drugs have been developed, and we know that all these different drugs have different side effects, that the development of many drugs led to too much choice and so to too much immunosuppressive schemes, leading to an heterogeneous treatment and also an heterogeneous follow-up of these liver recipients. If we look at the clinical practice today, we see that a lot of patients, and more over the last years, benefit from an induction immunosuppression using anti-lymphocytic serum. And if we look at the clinical practice of maintenance immunosuppression, one can see that triple immunosuppressive drug regimen is most used. And you see also on this slide that in fact mono drug immunosuppression is rarely used in any organ and also in a minority of liver transplant recipients. What is the result of the development of all these drugs? Over the years you see that the incidence of rejection lowered from 85 to 10% using a stronger and a more powerful immunosuppressive load. The incidence of rejection lowered, but if we look at the outcome of these patients, you see in fact that only the early survival of the patient improved, but if you judge the patient and you follow them 1 year after transplantation, you see that all lines almost remain horizontally, and this despite the fact that we treat less and less patients for a rejection, as you can see on this slide. So, no real improvement of long-term results. Why was this? Well, the explanation is very simple, as shown by this large population-based Nordic study. Many patients who are successfully transplanted, if we compare this with the general population, die in fact of infection, of cardiovascular complications, of tumors, and of renal failure. So the ideal immunosuppression should in fact aim to allow to accept the allograft and eliminate the risk not of rejection but of severe rejection. It should prevent infection and malignancy, and it should also reduce cardiovascular and renal events. This goal is commonly addressed by combining lower doses of different immunosuppressive agents, including steroids, but we know from clinical experience that this approach did not fulfill its promise. We should not forget that there is another element defining ideal immunosuppression, namely aiming at the best possible adherence and compliance. And we know from the literature that non-adherence and non-compliance in organ transplantation is the most pronounced in liver transplantation, reaching even 15%. And this non-compliance is of course related to the preparation of the recipient and the surrounding, to the collaboration and the availability of the transplant center, and to the magnitude of the medical therapy. The less medications you use, the easier it will be to follow your treatment and to go along with the advices of your medical team. So the search for the ideal immunosuppression is difficult because we are confronted with too much and too few attitudes. I will explain this later on. There is too much industry-driven and too few investigator-driven studies done in the field of organ transplantation. And indeed, I looked at this. You see, there have been hundreds of immunosuppressive studies done in the field of liver transplantation, but very few comply with the so-called JADAT5 rules. It means there are very few prospective, placebo-controlled randomized trials. There are almost no double-blind trials, and there are very, very few investigator-driven studies. And in many studies, the wrong questions are put forward, giving, of course, the wrong answers. There are almost no long-term follow-up studies also. So many of the studies have nice names, but in fact, they have not proven to bring a lot of benefit to the patient, except maybe one study. It was the one comparing tacrolimus with a microemulsion of cyclosporin. And this study has been published about 20 years ago, as you can see, showing clearly the superiority of tacrolimus in comparison with cyclosporin. And what was so important in this study? Well, it was an all-inclusive study done independently from sponsors or from industry. It was a standardized protocol, and there was an harmonization of the immunosuppressive treatment. Unfortunately, almost no studies were done looking at the same ideas and the same philosophy. So the search towards ideal immunosuppression is disturbed by the use of too much drugs, too much drug combination, too much industry-driven studies, too much wrong questions and answers, too much unclear results, too much early result reporting, too much missing pathology studies, and too much absence of global care. And the last argument has been addressed very well by one of the most famous liver transplant recipients, Steve Jobs, who said in his CV that when he was transplanted, he faced a problem that he had never permitted at Apple. Namely, there was nobody really in charge of his treatment, there was no cohesive approach, in fact, there was no global care of the patients. Why should we reduce immunosuppression? I said it already before, we should reduce the incidence of lethal side effects, we should reduce the metabolic syndrome incidence, we should reduce the incidence of renal failure, we should aim at improving the quality of life of the patients, but most of all, we should take profit of the rejection benefit and the chimeric benefit, which has been published already since more than 20 years. Indeed, as you can see on this slide, acute cellular rejection does not necessarily mean graft loss, but even means that you have a better long-term outcome. There were two major observations made during the last decennia, namely that rejection and tolerance are stages of the same continuum, and that extended organ engraftment under conventional immunosuppression is a manifestation of partial tolerance. The chimeric status, looking at an equilibrium between the graft and the host, can be kept even if we administer only one time in 14 days a dose of tacrolimus. So it shows that a lot of things can be done. What have been found in laboratory, it can be transposed to humans. So these two therapeutic principles may indeed enable the patient to bring him to a state of complete tolerance. So in my opinion, how should we now reason? We come from the heavy treatment, eliminating at any price rejection. We go to the light treatment, and we can even go to no treatment at all. I compare it with the Coca-Cola. You can take the full Coca-Cola, or you can take the Coca-Cola Zero without calories. And the liver is a privileged organ to minimize, as we said before, immunosuppression. There should also be a shift from steroid-free immunosuppression to minimization protocols. And we in Brussels opt already for more than 20 years to a single agent, if possible, infratherapeutic immunosuppressive scheme. First of all, we should eliminate the most nocive drugs causing the most severe lethal side effects. Several studies in transplantation have shown that transplantation can be done safely without the use of steroids and that good outcomes can be obtained, taking profit of what I said before, this immunoprivileged status of the liver. And we should not forget that it has been shown in the laboratory that the use of steroids can break the tolerance process. We in Brussels did a larger study on tacrolimus monotherapy in liver transplantation. You see, it is really a JADAT5 study. It was a prospective, randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled study. And we did not look only at 1 year, but also at 5 and now 10 year survival rates in these patients. And Starzl indeed was very pleased with this study. As he said to me, this study you have done is really a very unique one. I do not believe that anything so well controlled has ever been done in the field of liver transplantation. A second thing that we should take in mind when we do studies is that acute cellular rejection should not, in contrast to what is usually done, be the endpoint of your study, but that we should look in the long-term follow-up at chronic rejection and at graft and/or patient loss. So in this study, it was an all-inclusion study. You see, we use only tacrolimus monotherapy with a placebo control, and all these patients had a similar follow-up. And what is important is they were all followed by protocol biopsies, which were reviewed blindly by experienced pathologists. All-inclusion study is important. I give you a next slide to show you why. This is a recent study that was being published in the American Journal of Transplantation. And if you look at the exclusion criteria, you do indeed hear this famous belatacept study with the best patients you transplant. But this is not the reality of life. The reality of life is that you transplant patients in good shape, but also patients in less good shape and even in very, very bad shape. What is important, if you look at rejection studies, you should monitor the rejection by not only clinical or biochemical evolution, but you should do this also supported by histology. Protocol biopsies are important, especially in the beginning after transplantation, where the incidence of rejection is very high, as you can see on this slide. We developed in Brussels a so-called 7-up score. We combined the Banff grading with a biochemical score, taking into account bilirubin rates, eosinophilia rates, and a lowering of the platelet counts, which are all expressions of a rejection. And when we combine histology and biochemistry, you come to very, very different conclusions compared with those usually reported in the literature. Why did we choose eosinophilia? Because it has been well shown in any field of transplantation that it is the first parameter that rises if you do a rejection. Also, the absolute count of eosinophils is important. Once you go over 600, you know that you will find on the histology a more pronounced BAMF score. The platelets are also important. We know that they are destroyed initially after the transplantation, but that they start to rise normally after 7 days. It has been shown in several studies, as you can see here, and this is even the best shown, of course, in ABO incompatible transplantation or xenografting, indicating that when you have a destruction or an attack of the endothelium, that the platelets are destroyed. We published the first time this 25 years ago at the occasion of Starzl's 70th anniversary. We got a prize for this, and you see that in fact, when sticking to the 7-up score, you treat in fact about 1 out of 10 patients which shows on histology a severe rejection. And the importance of this is very well shown here, as you can see. If you do in all your patients a biopsy, only 1/3 of them have a BAMF score 6 or more, and you see that in the beginning only about 4% of the patients have a treatment for rejection. And if you look at corticoresistant rejection, only 1 to 2% of all your patients in this study, we had more than 450 patients, develop in fact a corticoresistant rejection. Another slide showing the importance of this approach is we did a study in Brussels combining tacrolimus monotherapy now with intraoperative high dose of anti-lymphocytic serum. If we looked at the biopsies under the microscope, you see that using anti-lymphocytic serum was significantly better. But if we look now at the patients that have been treated by applying this combined biochemical and histologic score, the so-called 7-up score, you see that there is no difference at all and that there is a very, very important reduction in the expression of clinical rejection. If we looked in the placebo-controlled double-blind study, you see that, in fact, if the patients that attack monotherapy a placebo or they attack colimus steroids, that the results of histology were exactly the same, and that almost all of the patients had, as you can see, infratherapeutic monodrug therapy. This is, of course, very important. We looked at the levels of the blood tacrolimus levels, and you see that there was no concordance with the BAM scoring, but in contrast, if we looked at the dosage of tacrolimus within the liver tissue, you can see that if we had a high concentration of tacrolimus in the tissue, we had a very low BAM score, and if we had a very low concentration of tacrolimus in the liver, we had a high BAM score. And we went even further, we looked at the level of tacrolimus in the peripheral blood mononuclear cells, and you see if this level is low, you have much more rejections. What are the results? You see no difference if you use tacrolimus monotherapy or you combine with steroids in relation to patient and graft survival, even if these patients have in 2/3 of them infratherapeutic monotherapy immunosuppressive scheme at 1 year. We looked at rejection. There was a significant difference in relation to corticoresistant rejection. It's rare. But if we excluded the patients who were at the moment of transplantation without artificial organ support, such as ventilation and dialysis, the results became exactly the same. We extended the results up to 5 years. No difference, as you can see, and even the actual survival of these adult patients was really excellent at 5 years. And you see the benefit of this monodrug therapy scheme. If you look at the renal failure after transplantation, is almost not existing if you apply such a scheme. We looked at the immunological follow-up of these patients. You see by continuously lowering the immunosuppression, as you can see, the results remained extremely good. If you looked at the biopsies at 5 years, you see what is classically found in liver transplantation. Only 40% of the patients have a normal biopsy, and some patients have a sinusoidal fibrosis or aspecific hepatitis. We don't know exactly yet what it means, but if you looked also at a patient that did not have a biopsy at 5 years, you see that the biopsies done a little bit earlier or much longer were in general compatible with normal findings or findings that you can see in the context of biliary tract problems. And this has been shown very well in follow-up studies of children, in which it was shown that fibrosis is present in 20 to more than 90% of biopsies, and that biliary findings are present in 2 to 40% of the patients. And we should not forget that many times, and we showed this in a large study that has been recently published, that many patients in fact have biliary problems, intrahepatic especially, despite the fact that the liver tests are completely normal. So if a patient has a late disturbance of liver tests, we must surely look at the bile ducts. Another advantage of minimization of immunosuppression is that you use much less immunosuppressive drugs. It is less costly. We looked at our patients and we published this also. You see that if you can reduce immunosuppression, there is an enormous gain of costs. This money can be used to do other interesting things in the field of liver transplantation. I was indeed very pleased to see that finally the Transplantation Society published in 2017 a position paper indicating that the endpoints of immunosuppressive drugs should change and should not be any more acute cellular rejection. But I was also surprised to see that even by including same authors, and it was said in the same year, in the same journal, that we should avoid under immunosuppression. I think I clearly showed to you that you can have extremely good results with infratherapeutic monodrug immunosuppressive schemes. So in summary, we come from over-immunosuppression. And over-immunosuppression, I compare this with what happened with the atomic bomb in, we know now, that Hiroshima, a city that was completely destroyed, has been built up completely. And we know also that the most aggressive opponents to atomic bombing or nuclear energy are those who survived Hiroshima. So what happens if you give a lot of immunosuppression to destroy completely the process of donor-specific activation and exhaustion deletion? Once you reduce immunosuppression, you get a clonal recovery with weaning and a rejection of the liver. I favor another theory, what I call the Vatican theory. You can reduce your immunosuppressive load, you can eventually use anti-lymphocytic serum, but in my opinion it is better to use a low drug dose, and then you have your normal clonal deletion exhaustion reaction, and when you wean immunosuppression, you will not have now anymore an attack of your graft. The next step is, of course, to go further in this evolution from immunosuppressive use in liver transplantation from 1985 to 2020. You see that the aims of the immunosuppressive approach have been changed. What can we further do? The endpoints changed. The next question is, can we go to patients which have no immunosuppression? The question is, of course, if there is a real benefit if you go from very low dose immunosuppression to no immunosuppression at all. Is this absolutely necessary? This is the question to put forward. And if you look at the literature, you see that in fact a lot of patients can be weaned of immunosuppression. But we should not forget that this low number of patients, we always speak about the same 500 to 600 patients, is in fact only a very, very small amount of all patients transplanted. It's a very, very highly selected group. And if you compare the number of patients in which immunosuppression was completely withdrawn with the patient cohort that was studied in the beginning, you see that in fact a low number of patients can come off immunosuppression. So immunosuppression withdrawal is possible. This is what these studies shown. Immunosuppression withdrawal has some risks. We should look at the development of fibrosis, but we must also look at possible biliary complications which can lead to fibrosis. Immunosuppression withdrawal safety can be improved if we do histology. We must have baseline biopsies without inflammation. We can monitor several biomarkers. And the more you prolong the interval between the transplantation and the immunosuppression withdrawal, the better is the outcome. But pathologic follow-up is a necessity. We looked in our experience if this is realistic, and you see indeed that we could reduce very, very heavily the immunosuppressing in about 1 out of 4 patients, and in about 5 patients, we in fact had no immunosuppression at all. The only counterback of this is that the patient is again now medicalized a lot, and the transplant team has a lot of work to do, especially when introducing routine biopsy follow-up. We looked at protocol biopsies, and we do this in Brussels since 20 years. You see that if you do biopsies at 5 or more years, that in about 1/3 of the patient, the immunosuppression can be lowered without any problem. So if you look at this slide, it means that if we want to do this very well, we must reorganize transplant centers, and we must introduce biopsy and ultrasound facilities, and then adapt the immunosuppression. So this is the evolution of immunosuppression in my center. I was long time out of my country. In 1994 I came back, and you see under my influence we reduced heavily the immunosuppressive load, and we go even now further and follow a little bit the Terazaki, the late Terazaki advice, drugs added when needed instead of started with high dose drugs and then go lower. We start low and we eventually raise when necessary. So the conclusions are that there is now a time for a definitive immunosuppression shift. We should come off of this idea that we have to eliminate at any risk immunosuppression, but we should now aim to reduce as much as possible the side effects of immunosuppression in order to reduce long-term morbidity and mortality whilst managing alloreactivity. So we should looking now at an almost immunosuppressive-free state. We must rethink the concept of standard immunosuppression. We must do more investigator-driven studies. We must refine markers for minimization and tolerance studies. and we have to rethink the transplantation follow-up. Short-term histology is indispensable, it is the science of transplantation, but long-term histology is also indispensable, but it is a necessity to progress. I come then to my final slide. Immunosuppression in organ transplantation, and especially in liver transplantation, is like an art. There is, of course, a place for different views, different opinions, different judgment, but there is also a mix of subjectivity and objectivity. But you have seen that by introducing the 7-UP score, we go to an almost complete objective evaluation of these patients. And I close with this quote from one of the most well-known scientists in the world, Claude Bernard. Immunosuppression is in fact an art. What is very simple is always wrong. What is complex is useless. So we should look at simple solution, and this works usually out well. So today I still drink only Coca-Cola Zero. I thank you for your attention, and I also thank you for the invitation to come to this very interesting and important scientific transplantation meeting. Thank you very much. Before giving the floor back to the chair, I just want to show this slide. I gave you my experiences gathered during 40 years. I like this quote also from Stasel. Knowledge is not meant to be kept for yourself. It's something that you should diffuse to others. So I forward to the audience what I have learned and experienced in 40 years in this field. And I end with my really final slide. I want to invite all of you to the 5th International Congress of Living Donor Liver Transplantation Group, which will be held, I'm sure, corona-free now in Hotel Le Plaza in Brussels, October 15, 16 of this year. You can find all information about this really important meeting gathering the top faculty of the world in this field of medicine in Brussels at the website ILDLT2021.org. Thank you very much for your attention.